Let's Talk podcast guests are invited to share their unique perspectives regarding diversity, equity, and inclusion. The ideas expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the practices of Mesquite ISD and are not an endorsement of any particular agenda or viewpoint.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, inspired by Mesquite ISD's Leadership and Empowerment Team, or LET for short.
Our guests include educators, students, and community members sharing their experiences from their perspectives.
So let's have a real conversation about embracing our differences and finding common ground with our hosts, Dr. LaDonna Gulley and Ted Madden.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast. We are down to our final two episodes before we put a wrap on the first semester of the school year. And we have another guest from outside Mesquite ISD, but someone who works closely with a lot of school districts across the country. We'll start with our introductions. My name is Ted Madden. I work for the communications department in MISD, and I'm a 48-year-old white man.
My name is Dr. LaDonna Gulley. I am the Director over Leadership and Empowerment for Mesquite ISD, and I am a 51-year-old African-American woman.
And I'm Lacey Pittman-Tamonic. My pronouns are she and her, and I am a 36-year-old, about to be 37 on Monday.
Oh, wow.
By the time the podcast comes out, you're a 37-year-old white woman.
I am a 37-year-old white woman. That's right.
Well, tell us about your professional background leading to where you are today.
Sure. So I grew up actually in Carrollton, went to Carrollton Farmers Branch ISD from kindergarten through eighth grade. Moved to Frisco for high school when it was still 1-3A high school.
You were there with just Frisco High before Centennial. Centennial was number two, right?
Yes. So my graduating class, which was 2003, we were the last ones to graduate from just Frisco High School. Yeah. So
now there's what, 15, 13?
Some crazy amount. Yeah. And they're all huge.
Yeah.
And I went to the University of Texas at Austin. I studied political communication and history. Grew up, I'm a seventh generation Texan, and I guess the first one born in the city, if you will. And so I've had an interesting background where I was the second person in my family to graduate from college. My dad did graduate from college. He likes to joke that it took him, 7 or 8 years to get through Texas Tech physical education program. But he made
it.
Yes. I went into college with a lot of privileges in the sense of being, a white person from more affluent suburbs and what people would consider a really high quality public education. But in a lot of ways, I also wasn't ready and wasn't prepared and didn't exactly know what to expect. And I would describe myself both as a child and as an adult as a very curious person. I don't just take things at face value. When I see things that, don't make sense to me, I ask questions. And so
I love to ask why.
Yeah.
That's a great question.
Yeah. And so, growing up when I would see, friends of mine that lived in different circumstances that I did or, didn't have the same, access to different things that I did, I always wondered why. And I was never satisfied with the answers that I got from grownups. And so that really has been a thread throughout my life, just kind of driving myself to ask why and to understand and to not presume that I knew the answers or that, everyone should be like me or have the same thing that I do. So that really drove me to be interested in public service. And I was considering the Peace Corps. And then I got introduced to a program called Teach for America. And, as cheesy as it is, I did a semester in Washington, D.C., my junior year of college, where I was interning at the White House. I mean, what an incredible opportunity, right? And I would be on the metro, going to the White House every day while also seeing, young Black kids in their school uniforms by themselves, going to school, having to go a distance on public transportation to get to a school that they felt like, that they and their parents felt like was high quality. And I remember talking to a kid one day and asked him, he'd been on the metro for a while and asked him where he was going and why. Just struck
just
up a conversation.
Him, just
yeah.
Why.
Just, yeah. And he was like, well, this is where we have to go to you know, my mom feels like good about this school and they have the programs that I want and that sort of thing. And I was like, wow, here I am going to this internship at the White House and this kid's having to make this sacrifice every day just to go and get what's guaranteed to him as an American, you know, child. And so that's when I decided to join Teach for America. Sorry, this is a very long-winded response, but at the same time, Hurricane Katrina was happening. And I was living in Austin at the time, obviously. And, you know, I was really disappointed by the way my fellow Texans were responding to the tragedy that was happening and the coded language that they were using to describe, you know, quote unquote, our schools are going to get worse, crime is going to go up, this sort of thing. And what they really meant is like, we don't want these poor Black folks coming into our community. And so those kinds of sets of experiences together is what really inspired me to join Teach for America and to teach high school English in New Orleans. And that's where I started my career. And I've done a series of things that since then, all kind of with the same thread of, you know, educational equity and this idea of leadership in education as my charge and my mission.
Mm-hmm. And just to clarify, talk a little bit about Teach for America. What is it? Because a lot of people still today don't know what is that.
Yeah. So we've been around for over 30 years. You are an alum yourself, Dr. Gully. That's why we know each other.
Yes.
She is an OG, we like to say. 92?
Yes.
Right?
Okay. I am a 1992 core member.
That's right.
It's in correlation right with my age.
Yes. And so anyways, the charge of the organization is the idea that, you know, every kid has the potential to do incredible things and achieve, you know, what they want to achieve in life. But there are systemic barriers that are preventing them from doing so, you know, often along the lines of identity, of course. And then the way our system was set up, like our system is set up to produce factory workers, right? But that's not the world we live in today. And so the charge is to really go dedicate at least 2 years of your life to teach in a low-income school district. We're in 50 communities across the United States, everything from, you know, indigenous reservation type placements to rural Appalachia to urban. And the thing is, and we get a lot of criticism often from folks saying, well, it's only 2 years. You know, you're coming in and you're leaving and you're actually churning the system. Over 80% of our alumni are still working toward educational equity in their life's career. And this is why Dr. Gully and I even know each other, right? Because we're still in this game. You cannot go into that experience and not be so transformed that you spend the rest of your career doing this work. That's what happened to me. I don't know what I thought I would go do after this, but I don't think that I would be sitting here today.
Was this your two years, was that Houston?
So my 2 years were in Houston, Texas.
And talked about that.
Yeah, and I have to say that, you know, you actually made me think of something about your why, right? Because we all have one. And so when I joined Teach for America, it was literally in its infancy. And
did we even have the internet then, really?
No.
Yeah,
no.
I didn't think
no.
so.
Mid-90s. Oh, wow. You just,
I think
early
I
90s.
Towards the end of my... I graduated college in 95, and the internet was barely.
Okay. Yes.
It was barely there.
Yes. And, you know, you said something that made me think about my why and why I joined. You know, I have a really unique background, living and growing up in Chicago, and then leaving a very urban, huge city to end up graduating in a little bitty town, about 12,000 people in Mississippi, and then moving on to Jackson State, and then so on. And I remember that although, you know, I don't think we had everything, you know, I, of course, had challenges just like anybody else, but I can remember being at Jackson State and thinking about how important it is to make sure you're giving back to your community and at the time, I wanted to go to law school, and that was really, really important to me. But I said, you know what? I'm going to take this little detour, and I am going to apply for Teach for America. And I had three jobs when I was getting ready to graduate. I was going to want to either go to the the Miami Herald and be a reporter. Or I was going to go and be a reporter for the Florence Morning News in South Carolina, Florence, South Carolina, or Teach for America. And literally said, no, I'm going to go and I'm going to teach. I'm going to teach. I'm going to make a difference. I'm going to do my 2 years, and then I'm going to go to law school. And truly, it was a transformative experience for me. I was volunteering at one of the local elementary campuses in Mississippi, in Jackson, before I graduated, did Teach for America. I have never been so scared in my entire life. I can literally remember the chalk chattering because I was so nervous. And my students sitting, my fifth grader sitting in the back saying, oh, she won't be here too long.
Oh, yeah.
She won't last. And I remember me thinking, they're right.
Yeah.
And so just that experience. And you're right. There is a lot of criticism with Teach for America. And yet people don't even understand what those core members give and what they do and how they walk away transformed.
Yeah.
I mean, you always become an advocate for public education. You have a real deep understanding of what equality and equity looks like. You also have a real stern understanding of what it doesn't look like. And you become a force to be reckoned with when it comes to what students have to have at every school building in our country. And so that has been why 29 years later, I am still in this. I still do this. I still do it with a smile. I love it. And I can't imagine my life doing anything else other than working for children and serving students.
And you are such an inspirational leader. And I remember when you were still principal at Florence, like visiting her campus was so special. Like it was just such a positive, like familial environment where everyone felt like they belonged, from kids to staff to everything. And now the work that you're doing
is so in line, right?
It's awesome. It's like the perfect evolution.
So how much of a difference can Teach for America make?
Wow.
Versus We're not getting it from the top, right? Huge changes have to come from the government, I think. So what can you do in your position?
Yeah, gosh, no small question there, huh?
Not on this podcast. Lower, you thought you were going.
So I think one of the like important misconceptions that I'll talk about a little bit with Teach for America is, you know, folks think that we are a just a teacher kind of placement program. And really, what we're a leadership development program. We're cultivating a very specific kind of leadership within our people. That's systems leadership. So you just mentioned the government, right? We would say that is like a key piece of this. You know, transforming the education system is a huge component of it. But if you're not also looking at healthcare, if you're not also looking at housing, if you're not also looking at all these other, you know, intersecting systems, you can only get so far. And so we're really trying to cultivate, you know, from when you're a fresh college graduate, this idea of systems leadership in your classroom being the first system that you're ever in charge of.
Yes.
Right. And so, you know, what do I think Teach for America can do? Like, I think Teach for America can change the country. And in fact, I would say I think it can change the world in a sense that our, you know, founder has gone on to start Teach for All. And we're in, you know, countries all across the world now, obviously a very, you know, taking the principles of Teach for America, but really it's about centering these other communities and countries, what they need and the model they need. And really, you know, working with homegrown leaders in these different places. And so,
That is definitely asset thinking. So when we talk about, you know, not giving you something that you think I need, but no, I'm going into the community. Let's work together. Let me find out what you need.
Yeah.
And then we'll work from there.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So I would just say, if you look at if you look at any kind of big revolution, evolution that's happening in education, more than likely there's some Teach for America alums behind it. And I can just share like a quick piece of my story. You know, after I finished my commitment in New Orleans, I moved to Washington, D.C., because I've always had this kind of political bug. And there was a young 27-year-old at the time, fellow Teach for America alum. I like to make fun of him because he looked real like dopey and his suits were too big. But he was so he so believed in the children of Baltimore, Maryland. And he was running for state senate. His name is Bill Ferguson. And I ended up getting connected with him and volunteering on his campaign. He is now the president of the Senate in Maryland. And he's, you know, worked on early childhood access and all of these incredible reforms for students and families in Baltimore. Like, that's the power of Teach for America.
Mm-hmm. That's leadership development.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
When you think about when you started teaching, what did you think it was before? And then what did you find out? And how has that impacted your work today?
Oh, man, what a good question. I think central to like my philosophy on life, but certainly teaching, is relationships. And so I knew the thing that I cared about was cultivating relationships with my kids. I think I thought of it more at the beginning as like one-to-one sort of thing, which, you know, that sort of individualism is a very seeped in white supremacy sort of value system. And something I'm unlearning as a white person all the time. You know, I hate to like say it like this because it sounds so bad, but it's honest. Like, I loved movies like Dead Poets Society and, you know, Dangerous Minds, right? This idea of like a hero. I don't know. It's problematic. Mm-hmm. but once I got in there, I realized like I was just part of a collective. And we were building and making things happen together. And it's funny because you talk about fear and you're chalk chattering. Like, I would be way more scared now to go start Teach for America than I was at 23. I mean, I just know so much more, you know? Mm-hmm. I know so much more, and my bar for myself is so much higher. And not to say I didn't have a high bar then, but I feel the weight of the responsibility that teachers have. And it's so massive and it's so hard. Yes. And we ask so much of them. They're therapists, they're instructional leaders, they're pseudo parents. I mean,
security guards, nurses, the psychologist,
yes.
The counselor.
Yes.
I mean, yes, there's about 20 different jobs encompassed under the word teacher.
Yeah.
Easily.
Yeah. Hardest thing I've ever done.
Yes.
Best thing I've ever done. But hardest thing I've ever done.
Yeah. I just think about what you've seen in education. You know, you brought up equity versus equality. I mean, there's got to be just a laundry list of all the, you know, of ways we can improve our public school system.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we give it lip service. We know that these kids are going to be the future. Mm-hmm. They are going to be adults in our society.
Yes.
It's in our best interest to do our best to make sure they have the maximum potential to become the adults functioning members of society.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of needs to happen?
I think there are so many incentives to keep the status quo in place at every level. And even really well-intentioned people feel the inertia of the status quo pulling them. And it's really complex. Again, I go back to this idea of systems leadership and systems change. Like, it can feel really daunting to say, you know, these five reforms are what's really going to do it, when you're like, oh, but gosh, you know, 10% of our student population is homeless, and, you know, 30% of our student population are English language learners, and are working jobs to help contribute to their family. I mean, there's, so I guess what I'm saying is I don't have the perfect list of things that I think are going to change things, but I do know that we have to look at things as the interconnected systems that mm-hmm. they are. And man, like this generation, Gen Z and whatever this upcoming generation yes. is called, like they give me so much hope. They make me so excited. They do not subscribe to a lot of this like status quo things that all of us
so true
were you know brought up to believe too, right? Yeah, like they don't question it.
And so we talk a lot about and we hear a lot about the word indoctrination, right? Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, we've all been indoctrinated,
yeah,
right, to believe what we believe,
yeah. Culturally, religiously,
yeah, absolutely,
socially, mm-hmm. racially,
yep. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Geographically?
Mm-hmm. Well,
yeah.
Yeah. And so you are right. I think as I have talked to so many of our students, our high school students, they question everything. Mm-hmm. And you're not going to be able to tell them anymore, even if you give them your why. It's not going to be necessarily good enough because they're watching and they're seeing and they're paying attention.
Yeah.
And I think that is really the difference.
Yeah.
They do give me a lot of hope. And thinking of that, I'm thinking about the social a couple of weeks ago where you were one of the panelists. What did you think of that? And what did you think about the students and the questions and things of that nature?
Yeah. Thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of that. It was really exciting. And just thinking about, like, you've stood up this department in such a short amount of time and have launched this program. And that room was packed with kids, like, it was incredible to see. I mean, y'all were feeding so many kids. Like, we started like 30 minutes later than we wanted to, uh-huh. right? Because that's how many people were there. You know, my impression was, I remember like looking out over all these students and thinking, they're actually looking at me.
Oh,
they're making eye contact. They're nodding. They're like, you know, kind of chatting with their friends about what they're hearing. Like, they were so deeply engaged. It was a Monday night, like, mm-hmm. you know, and they were there completely voluntarily. And I just mm-hmm. was like, the questions that they were asking, you know, even the way like some kids identify and present is just something that wouldn't have even happened when I was a teacher. And that was not that long ago. Like, this generation is just so much bolder, so much more comfortable. Like, they give me tremendous hope.
Uh-huh.
Tremendous hope.
So you presented to those students.
Yes.
And I always think about this. The rare times I'll present, I'm thinking they're not going to soak in everything.
Yeah.
What do you want them to walk off with?
Oof.
What's kind of the one message or one or two things you just, man, I hope that sticks.
Yeah. Gosh, what a good question. I think more than anything I would say, like, and I talked about this a little bit, but we have these preconceived notions of what leaders or change makers are, you know, what they look like, how they talk, what sort of roles or positions they're in. And I think this generation naturally, again, sort of shirks that. But I don't want them to lose that. Like, it's really easy going back to this idea of indoctrination. You go off to college, you get your first job, whatever. Like, it's really easy to yes. lose that belief that, like, I can be a leader and I can influence and change things from whatever seat I'm in. God, if they only took away one thing, I would say, like, affirmation that they are enough, that they have important things to contribute to the world.
Because depending on where they're from, they might be fighting the tide.
Absolutely.
The whole way through. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
But you want them to keep fighting.
Yeah. Yeah. If we're still trying to make change, like, we're going to need them.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to need them to get there. If we ever get there, like, we're going to need them.
How important is it going to be for students moving forward to really be able to own their level of truth and identity and everything that encompasses who they are? How important do you think that's going to play as students continue to matriculate through high school and then move on into mm-hmm. college and into jobs and things of that nature?
It's so important. And I know, quote unquote, identity politics, right, is this like controversial topic.
Mm-hmm.
But I have seen with my own eyes when kids feel like they are fully seen for who they are and they are not judged, the power in that, the self-acceptance that they feel. You know, I'll share vulnerably, like, I don't have as many marginalized identities, right? I'm a white woman, upper middle class, you know, came from an upper middle class family. And part of my identity that I've been grappling with for the last couple of years is I am fat. And that makes really people really uncomfortable when I say that. And I'm like,
interesting.
I'm actually like, I'm fat. I'm also pregnant right now, but like, I'm fat. That's part of my biology. That's part of my identity. It's mm-hmm. always been the case. And claiming that as just a neutral statement about myself and finding community with other fat people has been really powerful for me. And I'm almost 40 years old, you know, so I can only imagine being younger and having a more marginalized identity. Like, let's stop wasting time hating ourselves and trying to fit in, because it's keeping you from doing the powerful stuff that you can do.
My wife is talking a lot about this too. She's what is it? The We Can Do Hard Things, Glennon mm-hmm. Doyle.
Glennon Doyle. I've got her line from her tattooed.
Oh. Yeah. Wow.
But women in our society are supposed to look a certain way.
Yeah.
Right. And
yeah.
so, and it's a fight against the tide.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, it is, you know, we talk about indoctrination. In this country, we are thought to look at beautiful women are supposed to be fairly tall, mm-hmm. thin, and
blonde.
Light-complected. Blonde,
yep.
preferably.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You know, quote-unquote, preferably. And I remember there was another one of the Gladwell books. I bring him up a lot because I've read all his books.
He's good.
He's great.
He is
yeah.
good.
But there's that study about, or maybe, I don't know where it came from, but in other countries, the skinny model types look mm-hmm. malnourished.
Right. Uh-huh.
So in those cultures, that is not attractive.
Mm-hmm.
That means you're poor.
Mm-hmm.
If you're like, I don't know if it was in England. I mean, the darker your skin, it meant you worked outside. You were a peasant. It didn't. Mm-hmm. You know, the lighter your skin, the better off you were,
mm-hmm.
and it was a sign of your privilege,
your status.
Mm-hmm. But it's indoctrinated,
mm-hmm.
right? The way we define beauty mm-hmm. is indoctrinated. And again, individually, you can try to purge it out, and everybody should, but it's hard because
totally.
You can't change the world around you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But I think to your question, if more young people in this generation, especially as they enter the workforce and, you know, have economic buying power and that sort of thing, start saying, like, we're actually not going to accept this trash.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be our own people and we're going to show you that. Like, I think that's the change that will have to happen.
Mm-hmm. Would you do it again?
Oh, absolutely.
Why?
It changed my life. I mean, like, I don't know what I would be doing with my life. Like, every, you know, teaching fundamentally changed who I was. I still talk to my kids, a lot of them.
I do too.
Yeah. I texted one of my, you know, kids that I'm really close to, and it was her birthday. Her birthday is November 10th. Mine's the 15th. So we always, you know, text each other. And I was like, oh God, remind me again what number this is. She's like 29. And I'm like, you're 20, like you're almost 30. Like, she's a mom herself, mm-hmm. you know? And I mean, they've just changed my life. And, It's my purpose. It's my passion. And I really do believe that you have to, like, have the ground level experience.
Yeah.
You can care about, you know, educational equity, but if you are not proximate to the people that are being most impacted by whatever system of oppression they're experiencing, like, your view, I don't care how woke you are, like, your view is going to be limited. Mm-hmm. And I still, to this day, I'm like, I have to remain proximate to students because even my experience 10 years ago isn't enough.
Mm-hmm. You've got a 3-year-old boy, you said?
I do.
And you're pregnant with your second boy?
I do.
In February.
Yeah.
What are you going to teach your kids? And how are you going to teach them?
Again, all these tough, life-changing questions.
Oh, I know you've got a plan. You've thought about this.
I mean, gosh, I'm raising two white men, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, and I think about that all the time and the immense responsibility that is. More than anything, like, I am teaching my boys that this fine line between loving yourself, accepting yourself, knowing you're enough, but also knowing you're not that special. Like, in the sense that you're not entitled to anything.
I feel like that's one of our problems is we're a society of people who were taught that we are all special.
Yeah.
We're not.
Yeah.
We're unique.
Yeah.
Yes.
Unique and special are very different.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think a lot about like how my kids might identify from, you know, a gender perspective or who they might love and not trying to, you know, force them into boxes, but also not trying to overly engineer something either. So like my 3-year-old, he is a stereotypical, like he loves monster trucks, he loves dinosaurs, all those things. That's great.
You're right.
Let me nourish
that.
The things that he cares about and that he loves. But we talk about hard stuff. And I don't know if he gets anything that we're talking about yet, but like, you know, I choose books that show lots of different sorts of diversity and that mm-hmm. teach promising lessons. We don't watch shows that I'm like, you know, that I don't believe in the principles of what the shows are teaching. So it's hard for a 3-year-old, but yeah, I'm definitely already thinking about it. And my husband and I talk about it all the time.
Wow. What do you hope for? That's been my signature question.
Like, it's a little Donna signature at the bottom of that question. What do you hope for?
For my boys, for the world, for
the stage is yours.
What do I hope for? I hope for a world where everyone, the privileged, the not, feels loved by themselves, by others. I think a huge part of the reason why systems of oppression continue to exist is actually the self-hatred that those in power feel.
Yeah.
And so to feel completely accepted for who you are, to feel a sense of responsibility to other people, it's not just about you. It's not just about your family unit. It's great to love your family. That's a wonderful value to have. But if that's what you care about in lieu of caring about others, right now I'm watching Yellowstone. I don't know if y'all watch that show.
Yeah, I'm in on it.
Okay. But like the Duttons, man, he loves his family, but he doesn't care about anybody else. I'm only on season 2, so maybe it gets better. It
doesn't change.
Okay. I figured it didn't. But I want everyone to feel a collective sense of responsibility for those down the street from them, across the state from them, across the world for them. I think we would be in a really different place if that's what we felt.
Okay. That's Lacey Pittman-Tomonic, a vice president at Teach for America. Thanks. Good conversation. We appreciate it. So if you have questions for us or topics you'd like to discuss, send us an email at letstalk@mesquiteisd.org. You can find us at social media, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram by using the search term LETMISD. For Dr. LaDonna Gully, I'm Ted Madden. Let's talk again next week.